CPU coolers, they are not all created equally. And right here on the desk, we have three different types of coolers. We've got a H100i Pro, which Corsair sent in. They want some results. They want to see how well their coolers can stand the yes of the yes when it comes to stress testing. This CPU right here, which is the 32-core 2990WX. This thing can, if you want it to, put out a lot of heat. We've also got the Castle 280 liquid water cooler from Deepcool. Of course, both these companies make a big statement that have their coolers implementing RGB. All jokes aside, however, we've also got the Liqtech 240 from Enermax TR4. They've made their own special block on the actual base of the cooler itself, designed specifically for TR4. And speaking of TR4, the motherboard we are using is the ASRock Professional Gaming X399. Pretty much the best X399 motherboard you can get out there. Though, what are we waiting for? Let's put these coolers to the test and see if they can really handle 32 cores and 64 threads. This video is brought to you by ASRock with their H370 performance motherboards. If you're in the market for an 8th gen Intel CPU, even an i7, this board has you covered with a 10-phase VRM design. You can even control things like RGB fans and other components via the Polychrome RGB software, which you can use in both the BIOS and Windows. Click on the link in the description below to learn more. And here we are the next day. We finished up all the testing. We had a static ambient of 22 degrees Celsius, also with two different settings on these CPUs. The stock settings on the 32 core was using up around 245 watts, direct power being fed into the CPU. And also when it was overclocked, which we got it to 4 gigahertz, that was drawing roughly close to 400 watts, closer to 390 watts. We did get it to 4.1 gigahertz. However, we did get a crash across a couple of different CPUs here, which I believe is actually the VRM on the ASRock X399 Gaming Professional motherboard. However, after we did implement some cooling on the VRM, it did pass the test okay. But at that stage, we decided just to keep it at 4 gigahertz, which is more of a recommended setting, especially with 32 cores and 64 threads. So in another video, which we'll put the link for in the description when that's ready, we will be testing different X399 motherboards with VRM temperatures overclocked before and after VRM cooling solutions. So stay tuned for that. Now, of course, getting onto the coolers themselves, we managed to test three of the four coolers. The Corsair H100i Pro, unfortunately, didn't come with a TR4 bracket. If you wish to mount this to TR4, then you have to request the bracket either when you first purchase or post-purchase, and then Corsair will send the TR4 bracket out. Then you can mount that on the motherboard itself. So I didn't, unfortunately, have time nor the resources to test it. I could have put it on in sort of unconventional ways, but I feel it wouldn't be an apples-to-apples comparison then against these other three coolers, which did perform really well. So getting on with the results, Castle 280, when we had the stock settings, we got 59 degrees, 58 degrees, 58 degrees, and 55 degrees across the four different nodes. The CPU temperature itself, at least in hardware monitor, was reading up to 85 degrees. However, moving on to the Threadripper cooler, this did perform slightly better. We had 58 degrees, 57 degrees, 58 degrees, and 56 degrees across the four different nodes, and the noise as well. And we'll pull the graph up for the noise because this does paint a pretty interesting picture here with these three different coolers. We can see that the Threadripper cooler actually performed the best noise-wise out of all these three different solutions here, scoring both the best idle, overclocked, and stock settings of the three solutions. Well, actually, the Deepcool did come in with a better idle score. So when it comes to getting loaded up and you're playing games, the Threadripper air cooler is actually going to perform the best. We saw here when we overclocked, we saw 93, 91, 93, 89 versus 93, 93, 91, 85. And then moving down to the Enermax cooler, that scored phenomenally well, both on the node temperatures and on the max CPU temperature. I was actually very impressed, both stock settings and overclock settings. This easily won out of these three different coolers. Now, the Enermax cooler is 240 millimeters, but it is designed for Threadripper. The block size is a lot bigger. And since you do have a lot of heat going through the CPU to the block itself, getting the most surface area to touch the cooler is very important. And that's where Threadripper, the Enermax TR solution, does deliver. Of course, the Castle 280 performed well. So did the Threadripper air cooler. So all these three solutions we tested here today will do a fine job of cooling the 32-core CPU at 4 GHz. Now going above 4 GHz, if you want to go to 4.1 or even 4.2, if you dare go that high, I would recommend getting active VRM cooling and probably quite a sizable amount of that, as well as going with a bigger cooler, say a 360 or even a 480 mil rad, because this does put out a lot of heat, consuming directly to the CPU 400 watts itself. That was only on a 4 GHz overclock. So if you're going even higher, the diminishing returns does start to scale in. It will use up more power after this 4 GHz mark. So do keep that in mind. But what we saw here, again, three coolers were performing really well. The Deepcool itself has the RGB control. So you do get that bling. You do get the performance mixed in, and the build quality is actually really good. So I can recommend their new series of coolers. Even though they're not the best performing out of the three here, they do perform quite well and they do look aesthetically pleasing. The mounting kit as well is very straightforward. You do have to keep in mind though, if the RAM slots are too close to the CPU socket, like they are in the X399 bracket, you may have to orientate the cooler and adjust it 90 degrees to face north or south. In that case, you will have the logo facing a different way. That will then allow you to insert all your memory across the 8 different banks without it touching, as opposed to the pipes themselves going over and touching the left and right DIMMs. Also with the Castle 280, it does sort of stick up like a castle. I guess that's where the name comes from. The pump isn't noisy whatsoever. And as I said before, the build quality and installation is very straightforward and very easy. The cooler itself has a little mirror finish on the radiator, and of course the fans do look really nice, matching that of the actual block itself, which does all light up RGB. You've also got an addressable option there to plug up to your motherboard, or they include a controller if your motherboard doesn't have addressable RGB. You can hook it up via the SATA powered controller and then have manual control via the switch itself. With the motherboard, you can use the software, whether it's ASRock or ASUS's implemented proprietary software, you can use that to control the RGB. But more importantly, performance across all three coolers is there. The Enermax, of course, being the winner in terms of its raw cooling performance, but also the design is very straightforward too. You can mount it one way and the pipes go upwards. So it's gonna even clear, in this case, the ASRock board that we used here, it's gonna clear the memory banks from the get-go with its installation. And of course, that Threadripper air cooler, that's very good as well. You can install that with ease, screwing in the top 4 screws from the top of the cooler, and the design of that looks really nice as well. And now the last thing to talk about is pricing, and this is where things actually get a little bit complicated. So if you're in America, the Castle 280 is $130 USD. So it's not too bad considering it's got all the RGB bling, it performs pretty well. The Enermax cooler, the 240 mil, is the exact same price, $130 USD. That is available in America. Castle 280, however, is not available in America, but that's available in Australia for 199 AUD. And then the Enermax TR4 isn't available in Australia. So basically, the only cooler available in Australia is the Deepcool, and then the only cooler available in America is the TR4 out of the coolers you've seen in this video, because the AMD TR4 cooler itself, I don't see that for stock anywhere at the moment. So there it is with stock. But I hope you guys enjoyed today's video. If you did, then be sure to hit that like button. If you have any questions or comments about cooling Threadripper's 32-core behemoth, then be sure to drop a question in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. And if you do enjoy this content, then you can hit that subscribe button, hit that bell notification so you're notified as soon as the videos come out. But also I'll be releasing that VRM motherboard comparison, so stay tuned for that. And I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.